evening, dear students and viewers. So today I am going to discuss with you about manufacturing process of a concrete. So this is an engineering method, how to manufacture a concrete and its different ways is being discussed here. Let us start. The process of manufacturing of concrete, this will abide as per the VTU regulation and module is 2.3. So if you are manufacturing a concrete, there are sequential steps one by one which you have to know in order to manufacture an engineered concrete. So what do you mean by engineered concrete? There are steps in order you should follow that to get the optimum required mode of concrete. We will progress. Technically, it is necessary for us to know what are all the good rules to be followed in each stage of manufacturing concrete for producing good quality of concrete. There are various stages which we will look into it, and in detail we shall discuss. First thing is batching, mixing, transporting, placing, compacting and curing. These are the series of steps should be followed in order to manufacture a good concrete. So what do you mean by batching is, for each and every concrete is being identified by the grade of a concrete. If you say a concrete, then the concrete has a technical name called grade. So that grade represent the strength of the concrete. So if you are making a concrete, you can make a concrete for a 10 Newton per mm square strength, that is 10 MPa, 20 MPa, 100 MPa, or you can go up to 500 and 600 MPa compressive strength of a concrete. So up to that you can move. So how we are making that much strong concrete? A concrete can be made as strong as the rock. It can be manufactured even more stronger than the rock. How we can manufacture that kind of a concrete, which depends on a certain process. We have to do a mixed design for a concrete. For that, after mixed designing, the next process for manufacturing a concrete is known as batching. We have a set of ingredients, so we have to mix all the ingredients to get the required strength of the concrete. Say for example, M20 grade concrete, you need 1.53, that is 1:1.5:3 grade of concrete. So what do you mean by that? One part of cement, say for example, I am assuming 50 kg of cement, you have to take 75 kg of sand and 100 kg of coarse aggregate, that is 1:1.5:3. If you are making it as 3, then you have to take 150 kg of coarse aggregate. If you mix this aggregate, then along with the ingredients you will get a concrete with the grade of M20. It withstand a load of 20 Newton per mm square, and after that you will get the stress carrying capacity of the concrete. So higher the stress carrying capacity, the stronger the concrete. There are two methods of manufacturing of a concrete. While batching, you can do it by hand mixing or by a concrete mixer machine. So what do you mean by batching is, the measurement of material for making concrete is known as batching. It is generally how much quantity of ingredients which we are producing in order to make a concrete. First one is batching, that is volume batching and weight batching. Volume batching is generally used for any small kind of a job, and It is used for unimportant work. That is, you can say, for an example, the unimportant work can be the work related to gardening wall and parking curb oriented concrete work. So these are all less strength oriented structure, so there you don't need a more finer batching. So there, at this particular point, you can use volume batch of concrete. Here we are using gauge boxes, are used for measuring fine and coarse aggregate. Gauge boxes are it can be a metal or a wood box. It has the certain length, breadth and width. If you measure one quantity of cement, you have to take the 1.5, that is 1.5 times the box of sand and 3 box of sand. It is very used to mix. Even unskilled worker can manufacture a concrete, so they don't need any kilogram or weighting the ingredients. They just have to take the number of boxes they are using for the concrete work. Generally, the gauge box will be 35 liters for the one bag of cement. Next thing is weight batching. So this is mostly used in ready mix plant, and it is the advanced method than volume batching. It is used for larger work. If you have large number of work for a concrete, then you can go for weight batching. It gives a better control of a concrete. So it has a recorder, and it shows graphically the recording components of each and every ingredient with each and every batch. Say, for example, if 70 m3 material is concrete material is required, if 12 or 15 number of truck is required to transport the material, for each and every truck they will follow a certain batch of a concrete. If all the mixture are similar and all the batch of a transporting machine follows the same material, so which you can track and you can compare with the mix design. So whatever we are following theoretically should be actually match with the record which we are manufacturing of concrete. So this weight batch gives accuracy to handle, and while checking the concrete for further purpose. Yes, here you can observe the cement, sand and coarse aggregate in the figure. That is, you are having 1:1.5:3. Here you can observe that. So this is M20 grade of concrete, that is 50, and in liters it is given here 1:1.5:3. This is the grade of M20, and towards it is indicating the lean mix of a concrete. When coming to the next figure, so this figure along with the table indicates the approximate quantity of surface water. You can think that all the sand are dry, that is woven dry. There is no 0% of water. We can assume theoretically, but practically, if we say all the sand content, that is coarse aggregate and fine aggregate, have certain quantity of amount of water in it. So it is being assumed as, when the sand is very wet, it can be assumed as 120 liter per meter cube of water which is available in the sand. So you can add the remaining number of water when you compare with the mixed design. So if you are having a moist gravel or crushed rock, you can observe that 20 to 40 liter per meter cube, you can assume it as pre-determined water which is available in the sand. So you can add the remaining quantity of water and you can check the compatibility with mix design and the concrete mixing process. Next process is known as mixing. Now we have batched the concrete by using two method, that is by using a volume batch and weight batching. Now mixing. What is the purpose of mixing? Mixing is essential for production of uniform concrete. The concrete should have a uniform color. Hence, we are going for a thorough mixing process. While mixing a concrete, it should ensure that mass becomes homogeneous, uniform in color and consistency. So it should have a consistency towards all the mixture of the concrete. So there are two types of mixing of a concrete. One is hand mixing and next one is machine mixing. So hand mixing can be used for small scale and unimportant concrete works. You can use that hand mixing technique. So it is desirable. Generally, you have to add 10% of more cement to a concrete in order to achieve the better strength while you are going for a hand mixing. If you are doing for a mixture machine, so the exact quantity of cement is enough. If you are doing for a hand mixing, then you have to go for a 10% of increased cement. Why? Because it gives a better mixing when you are using a concrete mixture machine. So due to the inability of a worker to mix the concrete well, hence you are using additional 10% of cement. How to do a sequential steps for a hand mixing of a concrete? So first you have to spread out the coarse aggregate and the fine aggregate in alternate layers. First layer should be coarse aggregate and next layer should be fine aggregate. It should be spread evenly. Next thing is you have to pour the cement on the top of it. So you can imagine that there are a coarser aggregate and the finer aggregate is being fine aggregate. That is, finer aggregate is being added on the top of that, and more finer material is cement. So you are adding above the material. Finally, the water is being mixed on the top of the cement. So you can see the steps. The coarser material is at the bottom layer and the finer, more finer material is coming up the layers. So before you are applying the water, you have to mix the three components thoroughly. Then after that you will get a uniform color. After that you have to sprinkle the water in order to get a very good hand mix. The operation of hand mix should be continued till a good uniform homogeneous concrete is obtained. So if you are visibly seeing the concrete, it should have a uniform and homogeneous mix, and it should have a uniform color throughout the ingredients. So here you can observe the concrete mixture machine. So this is a laboratory tilting drum mixer. There are different types of mixer available. According to the mixer and according to the blade and tilting operation and amount of revolution, all the components which is added in order to make a desirable concrete. So all the parameters are taken into account. It affects the concrete quality. Here you can observe that if you are mixing a concrete, you are having a graph here. This graph indicates in y-axis compressive strength and x-axis time of mixing. You can note that if you are doing a mixing of a concrete for less than 1 minute, you can see that strength of the concrete decreases. We can compare with the 28 day strength. See that the concrete strength decreases up to 10 Newton per mm square. When you are mixing the concrete up to 10 minutes, you can observe that nearly a twice of compressive strength is being increased. So while you are mixing a concrete, you should be make sure that enough amount of homogeneous mixing is being followed. If you are mixing the concrete ingredient for 10 minutes, you are getting the optimum result while you are manufacturing a concrete. So you should follow this. No materials in a concrete should be mixed less than 2 minutes. So more than 2 minutes you have to mix. At least if you need a optimum quantity of strength, then you have to do 10 minutes of mixing for achieving the better concrete. If you are going for machine mixing, this is used for large scale mass concrete works. So you cannot go for a hand mixing for large quantity of work. You can go for machine mixing. It is very much time efficient and it is economical for producing the large concrete. So the drum may be either classified as tilting, non-tilting. So you can tilt the drum or you cannot tilt the drum, and reversing or forced action type. So you can reverse the drum to the opposite direction in order to pour that. So these are the different types of drum which is available. So you can use according to the purpose. I have indicated the same thing, the shape of the drum, the angle and the size of the blades. The blades inside the drum also is taken into account in order to get a efficient mixing of a concrete, and the angle of the drum. These are the reasons which is important to get a effective concrete. Generally, a mixture machine run at a speed of 15 to 20 revolution per minute. So for a proper mixing of a concrete, you need 25 to 30 revolution. That is, you need a minimum 2 minute of revolutions in order to achieve the optimum concrete, which we have discussed in the earlier slide. So next thing is transporting a concrete. After batching, you are making all the ingredients at a particular weight. Then you are thoroughly mixing the concrete. While mixing, according to the type of work and importance of work, you are classifying two types of mixture machine. And next, the concrete should be transported. After mixing, the homogeneity of the concrete should be maintained. So this is known as transporting. Whatever the homogeneous material you have arrived in the concrete, it should be maintained until it is being poured in the exact place where you need the structure. So for that, different types of transporting mode is available. You have to opt according to the type of work which you are casting. So these are the types of transporting which is available for concrete, that is mortar pan. So these are all hand mixing oriented apparatus which is used for transporting a concrete. By manual labor, the mortar pan, there will be a pan. This mortar pan can be transported from one hand to the other hand by using the workers. So it can be used for some type of work where the manual transporting can be available. There are some cases where a human cannot go to the exact place and pour the concrete. In that case, and to get a better and quick work. If you need a quick work and if you need to reduce the manpower, you can use a wheelbarrow or hand cart. Next thing is crane, bucket and ropeway. So for higher floors, so that is more than 3 or more floors, it is practically much more difficult to transport the concrete by using the labors. So hence, by using a crane, so there will be a crane and a pulley, so they will transport the concrete from the lower story to the top story by using the crane and bucket and ropeway. Next thing is truck mixer. So this truck mixer and dumpers. So if you are having a concrete mixer at a particular place and if you are having a horizontal distance more than 100 meter or 200 meter, then you can use a truck mixer and dumpers. So truck mixer, you can see more ready mix plant are using truck mixer. So in order to get a concrete to be transported quickly from one end to another end, so you can differentiate crane, bucket and ropeway versus truck mixer. If you are having vertical distance to be covered for transporting a concrete for higher elevation, you can use crane or a bucket. And if you need a longer distance to travel, that is a site is there more than 1 kilometer or 10 kilometer from the manufacturing part, generally ready mix plant will batch and mix at a particular area and they will transport to the site. So they generally use truck mixer or dumpers. So dumpers are similar to the truck mixer. So in the truck, instead of mixer, a dumper is being provided. Next thing is belt conveyors. So belt conveyors are used from one end to another end, the concrete is being transported at a particular site. So belt conveyors are generally used for prefabricated structures. So if you are manufacturing a concrete in a particular area, in a particular workshop, within that workshop you can manufacture a concrete, you can transport by using belt conveyors. So generally chut. So this type of transporting element is used when a human cannot go into a particular place and place the concrete. Say for example, if you are making a high dense, high mesh oriented reinforcement, if you are doing for a foundation, if you are casting a concrete for a foundation, in that it is difficult to get the labors inside the foundation and cast all the mat of the foundation. During that period, that transporting mode is being used, and skip and hoist. Next is transit mixture, truck mixture and transit. Transit in the terms, it can transit from one place to another place by a revolving drum, similar to ready mix plant. Pump and pipeline. After the transporting a concrete ready mix plant, so they will have a pump and a pipeline. Through the pipeline, the concrete is being pumped at higher elevation or for the distant point. You can deliver a concrete at a particular area by using pump and a pipeline. Finally, a helicopter can also be used for transporting one area to another area where a vehicle cannot move, where you don't have any transport mode by land. So hence you can use a helicopter mode for transporting a vehicle. Here you can observe that this is a truck dump, so which you have truck dumpers. So this is the picture. You can, so here they will dump the concrete and they will supply to the particular area. This is a truck transit mixture and a truck mixture. So here you can After mixing the concrete, they will pour into the truck, and this mixture machine will revolve till it reaches the particular point. After it reaches the particular point, you will have a pump and a pipe. So it will pour the concrete in this pan. This pan has a hose here. By using this hose, it is supplied to the particular place by using a pipe. So here you have a pump, so you can generate a force. So by this force, the concrete is being transported to another place or to the required place. This is a chuck oriented transporting of a concrete. See, you are having a dense mesh in the area. You cannot get inside the area to pour a concrete. For this oriented purpose, you can dump the concrete in the chuck, so it will automatically pour in this particular area. You can use vibrators in order to compact all the concrete. So this is another mode of transporting. Now let us come to placing of a concrete. The concrete after placing, so now you have transported all the concrete and it should be placed at a particular point. The placing can be, the concrete can be placed for a beam, for column, for slab, foundation elements, and for walls. So these are the different types of placing of a concrete. According to the placing mode, the concrete placement is being differed. Example, placing of a concrete within an earth mold. Here, when you are placing a concrete in a foundation level, example, for a foundation concrete or wall or for a column, then the concrete can be placed according to that. Next thing is placing of concrete with large earth mold or timber plank formwork. So this is large earth mold in the sense road slab and airfield slab. So you will be having a large area you have to pour the concrete. Note that if you are placing the concrete, you cannot dump the whole of a concrete. If you are having a 6 m³ of a concrete in a mixture machine, you cannot dump all the concrete at a particular point. So all the concrete will be heaped in a particular area. You cannot do like that. How you have to place this? You have to place the concrete layer by layer. If you are having a mass concrete or the concrete has very large depth, you have to cast the concrete for 15 centimeter to 20 centimeter. For each and 50 to 20 centimeter, you have to place the concrete, compact well. After that, you have to place the next layer and you have to compact well. Like that, you have to compact all the concrete layer by layers. If you are having 1 meter depth, say for example, it can be more than 2 meter height of a concrete. It is more than the height of a human. So during a casting of a bridge deck and for retaining walls, so these are the place you will have a mass concreting. There you have to place the concrete by layer and it has to be vibrated for each and every layer. Note that if you are making one layer and then you are placing another layer, you have to make sure that a bond is being achieved for both the layers. Hence they will place a concrete, they will place generally a coarse aggregate. So this coarse aggregate is being placed at the top of the concrete in order to get bonding between two concrete. Say for example, in a column, if they are casting a column, in this column you will have at a stretch of, say for example, 10 feet. After 10 feet, if they are raising the shutters, and after that you have to make another level of a concrete, make sure that the concrete should be casted in the first layer and some coarse aggregate should be placed on the top of the concrete in order to get a better bonding. Then if you are casting a slab, for payment slab, say for example, for one layer of payment and the next layer of next series of payment or the next layer of payment, you shall have a reinforced bar in order to connect the both the layers. So you should make sure that both the layer by layer is being connected and it acts as a homogeneous member. So these are the types of concrete that is placing with large earth mold for timber plank work. So this is for road slab, for which we have dealt. Placing of concrete in layers with timber or steel shutters. So then placing of concrete with the usual formwork. These are the examples are highlighted. Yes, when placing a concrete, this is the first case. If you are placing a concrete at the first layer of a foundation, you should make sure that the earth should not be loose. After digging all the soil, the earth will be loose. You should make sure that you should ram the area, then only you have to add the plain cement concrete, that is PCC. Whenever you are laying a concrete in earth, you should make sure that the earth layer should be rammed. After that, you should sprinkle some water. The water should be sprinkled in order you should be kept damp. Why? Because if you are adding the optimum quantity of water for a concrete and if you are placing the concrete in that soil, the soil generally absorbs some water. So this reduces the hydration effect of the concrete. So so that you should be careful that in order the water should be sprinkled minimum and then you have to go for the concrete. Or else you can go for a polythene sheet. You can warp a polythene sheet. After that you can place the concrete in the foundation layer. And another thing, that the organic matters, grass and root leaves should be removed. Why? Because it affects the durability of the concrete. If organic content is being included in a concrete, it progresses other durability effects. So this we have discussed. The third point is being discussed earlier. The concrete cannot be heaped at one place and then it cannot be dragged. This process should be avoided. So you cannot heap a concrete as like sand and you cannot drag like that. You have to go layer by layer. This is what we have discussed. So that layer should be 15 to 30 centimeter thickness for mass concreting. Next thing is, for each and every layer, if you are having a horizontal thrust, that in the sense, if you are going for a pavement slab, then you will have a horizontal thrust in the slab. So generally, in the slab which you are casting for a structure or housing, generally it has very less amount of horizontal thrust, that is horizontal force. So you will not have more horizontal force. When you are having a horizontal thrust, that is in the sense while casting a bridge deck or when you are casting a pavement slab, then you have to add bond bars, that is each and every layer of the sand should be bonded, and bond rails or bond stones should be provided for good bonding purpose. Yes, this is an important tabular column. Note here that the type of formwork, serial number, type of formwork and minimum period before striking the formwork. Note that if you are casting any column, say for example, if you are working as a site engineer, you have to plan for the work next day and for the next week. You have to plan according to the material availability and you have to match both the things. What work to be done, what material is there, how you can plan that. If you are having 50 number of shutters, You have to plan that. Then you are having 200 number of columns to be casted. You have to plan that when you are casting 50 number of columns, at least 16 to 24 hours. After that, only you can cast the remaining columns. At least you need 4 days, 3 to 4 days. You need 3 to 4 days for casting all the 200 columns. Why? Because you are having 50 number of column shutters. Each and every column shutters is being casted. After 16 to 24 hours, then you can remove the column shutters. You can mold a next shutter for the column. Like that, if you are performing a formwork for slab, a slab concrete is being laid, and after laying the slab concrete, you can remove the formwork after 3 days. The under the slab of the concrete, you can remove the shutters after 3 days. The props to be refixed immediately after the removal of formwork. There will be props. Above that prop, you will have a slab shutters. So you can remove the slab shutters, and after that you should place the props. Like that, you can note here that for the soffit of beams, you need 7 days. Why? Because the slab load goes to the beam. That is why you can remove the slab shuttering first. After that, you have to remove the beam shutters, and you have to place the props after removing the shutters. Note that first you can remove the shutters in the slab. After 7 days, you can remove the props in the beams in order to achieve the very good bonding and the particular place of a concrete will not be disturbed. Here another 2 points is being given. Props of a slab spanning up to 4.5 meter, 7 days. If you have a large span, more than 4.5 meter, say for example, generally a classroom has more than 4.5 meter of a span. At that particular place, you need 14 days in order to remove the prop. You can remove the shutters, but you cannot remove the prop. You have to place the prop and remove after 14 days. Next thing is compacting of a concrete. This is the next process of concreting. After placing, you should compact a concrete. So the process adopting for expelling the entrapped air from the concrete, the following methods are adopted for compacting the concrete. Why you are performing a compaction? That is, you are removing the entrapped air. So 1 to 2% of entrapped air is being permissible. Above that, you cannot allow the entrapped air. Why? Because this entrapped air provides the void in a concrete, and this void reduces the strength, and it allows all the external agents into the concrete, and which makes the concrete very lean. So that is why you have to compact the concrete very well. Everything is a important work. See, a fresh concrete has, after mixing the water, you are doing batching, mixing, placing, transporting, compacting. Placing, then compacting. See, everything should be taken care. If you take care within this 2 or 3 hours of a concrete, which gives a very high quality of a concrete. If you are not having a particular interest, or if you are not performing a good quality of a concrete, the sense quality in the term fresh concreting is, in a fresh concrete, the quality is, if you are performing all the sequential steps correctly, then the quality which goes to the optimum, it gives a optimum concrete, it gives the most efficient concrete. In order to get a qualitative concrete, it is not designing or it is not theoretically saying everything. This is a very important topic where theory and practicality merges together. Whatever you can design in a lab and whatever you can mix a concrete, you can cast n number of specimen, you can test everything. But when you are doing an exact material or when you are casting an exact structure, these five sequential steps are very, very important to bridge a very good concrete. These five steps are bridge between a theoretical concrete versus a practical existing concrete. If this bridge is properly or qualitatively achieved, then whatever you are being thinking theoretically is exactly can be achieved in the real world. So that is why you have to take care of each and every step. So now we are discussing the compaction of a concrete. So the compaction can be done by rodding, that is hand compaction, or by ramming and tamping. So by using a steel rod, you can compact the concrete. So this is used for column and beam work. So there will be heavy mesh of a steel. You can rod the concrete in between the mesh of the concrete. So then ramming. So the ramming can be done, and ramming and tapping can be done in the top surface of the slab and top surface of the beam element. These are all hand compacting procedures. Next thing is compaction by vibration. So there are different types of vibration, that is internal vibrator, that is needle vibrator. So there will be a long needle. So this long needle can be inserted into a concrete and it will be vibrated by using a long needle. So this kind of a concrete can be used for column work where you don't have any place. You cannot even look into the place, either it has been compacted or not. You cannot view the particular point. Say for example, for a pile concreting, you cannot view what is the status of the compaction. At that particular area, you can use the needle vibrator. That is, next one is formwork vibrator, that is external vibrator. Even the formwork which is being placed can be used as a vibrator by using the machine, external vibrating machine. This is external vibrator. Next is table vibrator. So this table vibrator is generally used in experimental work for laboratory purpose. After mixing all the ingredients, there will be a table. By using the table will vibrate according to particular frequency in order to mix all the components. So this table vibrator is generally used in laboratory purpose. Platform vibrator, this is used for pavement area, for pavement of a road, concrete road. And surface vibrator, vibratory roller. So vibratory roller can be used for concrete. This can be a concrete roller or a bitumen roller. So the roller machine is available. So this roller machine is not only static, there are dynamic roller machine. The roller, road rolling machine can act as a vibrator. This is an advanced equipment. While rolling by the road roller, you can have a particular vibration in order to compact the pavement. So compacting can also be made by using compacting by pressure and jolting, compaction by spinning. So by spinning you can make the compaction. So these are the types of equipments which are available for different types of work. So this is the table vibrator which is used for experimental purpose. This is the needle vibrator. You are having up to certain length. By using this length, you can extend up to the place where you can go and compact. So this is needle vibrator. This can be either be electrical or by petrol. So you can use by the two method of fuel. And this is a plate vibrator, this is used for a slab oriented compaction. And here you can observe a table which gives the optimum acceleration, how much of acceleration or how much of vibration the vibrator can be produced in order to fulfill a particular work. If the length of the vibrating needle is 350 mm, up to 350 and 250 to 500 and 250 to 700, if the depth is keep on increasing, if the depth of the needle is increased, then you can have a better acceleration. Recommended frequency of a vibrator under load state. So you can have a 7000 vibration per minute. So you can use if you are having a long vibrating needle, hence you can have a less vibration per minute. If you are having a short vibrating needle, you have to do for higher vibration per minute. Here you can observe the vibration needle is also increased. For the particular application, you can use the type of vibrator. And last, an important graph. Here you can see that why we are compacting a concrete, to reduce the air voids. If you reduce or if you have 0% air void, then there is no loss in strength of concrete. There will be exactly no loss. Whatever you, if you are manufacturing a concrete that is M20 grade, exactly your grade of the concrete will be M20. Say for example, if you are manufacturing M20, then you are not compacting the concrete well. If the air void is 30%, see, 90% of the strength is reduced. Finally, you are getting nearly M2 grade concrete. Compacting is a very, very important phenomena. Why? Because if 20% of air void is there, 10%, drastically the loss of strength of concrete is being highlighted here. So if you are keeping up to 10%, that is practically if you are theoretically 1 to 2% of air void is only being allowed, if you are not going above that, then it is well and good. You will have 100% of the strength what you need to achieve. So from this is a very lengthy topic and very important topic to discuss with you, dear students and viewers. Why? Because there is everything in civil engineering has a practicality. Whatever you are doing in lab and whatever theoretical work you are doing should match the exact structure and exact thing which you are building in the real world. There are certain parameters in all civil engineering aspect. These parameters should be taken care. This parameter is known as quality of a concrete. This five technique, this five process while manufacturing a concrete, if you perform all the process from batching, if you follow weight batching, you will have more quality of a concrete. Then if you have batching, then mixing, if you have a concrete mixture machine, then you will have a better quality of a concrete. Like that, in all the process, if you follow the better method, then the quality of the concrete increases. Then whatever you are thinking in the research center or theoretically will definitely be achieved in the practical scenario. So this is what you have to keep in mind for better casting a structure. If you have any comments or doubts, you can feel free to discuss here on the comment link. So I am happy to discuss with you Generally, I am happy to teach and happy to share. I hope this lecture will help you a lot in understanding the process of concrete. Have a good day. Thank you.